Do these 5 things in order to lower your blood sugar levels fast. High blood sugar is not random. It's the result of 3 things happening at once. First, glucose is sitting in your bloodstream instead of being pulled into muscle. Second, your liver is releasing extra glucose, often in response to stress hormones. Third, insulin signaling is impaired because the cells it targets have become insulin resistant. So, the fastest way to lower blood sugar is not one magic trick. It's pulling multiple levers that all point in the same direction. Improve glucose uptake, reduce liver glucose output, and calm the hormonal signals that push sugar levels higher. Let's walk through the 5 most effective ways to do that, starting with the one that works even when insulin isn't cooperating. Number 1, move your body for 15 minutes. Turn your muscles into glucose vacuums. If you want the closest thing to an emergency brake for high blood sugar, this is it. When your muscles contract, they can pull glucose straight out of your bloodstream without needing insulin at all. And that's a big deal because if you're insulin resistant, insulin is the very signal that's struggling to work in the first place. Here's an easy way to picture it. Insulin is like a key. Your muscle cells are the lock. In insulin resistance, the key isn't gone. The lock is just rusty. It turns slowly, inconsistently, and sometimes not at all. But muscle contraction opens a side door. When you move your body, your muscles activate a completely different pathway that pulls glucose into the cell independent of insulin. No key required. The door just opens. That's why something as simple as walking can drop your blood sugar when food changes or medication aren't doing much in the moment. We see this clearly in human studies. In a controlled trial published in Diabetology, people with type 2 diabetes who did light to moderate walking after meals had significantly lower post-meal blood sugar levels and better glucose control across the entire day compared to people who stayed seated. And this wasn't intense exercise. No gym, no sweating buckets, just walking. What's even more interesting is that the effect didn't stop when the walk stopped. Muscle insulin sensitivity stayed higher for hours afterward, meaning glucose continued moving out of the bloodstream and into muscle long after the activity ended. Now, here's the part most people don't know, and this is huge. If you can't walk, you're stuck at work, sitting on a plane, dealing with joint pain, or just don't have the option, you can still activate one of the most powerful glucose-clearing muscles in your body. It's called the soleus, that deep calf muscle underneath the big gastrocnemius you see in the mirror. The soleus is built almost entirely out of slow twitch muscle fibers. That means it's designed to burn fuel continuously for long periods without getting tired. It's basically a glucose burning engine that loves steady work. Researchers recently showed that repeatedly raising and lowering your heels while seated, what we call soleus push-ups, significantly improves local glucose uptake and oxidative metabolism, even without full body exercise. In plain English, you can lower your blood sugar while sitting down. So if your glucose is high right now, here's what to do. Walk for 10 to 15 minutes at an easy, comfortable pace. If walking isn't an option, sit tall, keep the balls of your feet on the floor, and lift your heels up and down continuously for 10 to 15 minutes. And I want to reframe something important. If your blood sugar doesn't drop immediately, that doesn't mean this didn't work. Muscle keeps pulling glucose for hours after activity. This isn't flipping a light switch. It's opening a drain. You're reducing the pressure now and making it easier for your body to handle glucose later. That's why movement is one of the fastest, safest, and most reliable tools you have when blood sugar is running high. Number 2, drink water, because dehydration makes high blood sugar look worse. This one sounds almost too simple, which is why most people underestimate it. But physiologically, hydration plays a much bigger role in blood sugar than people realize. When blood glucose rises, your kidneys respond by pulling water into the urine to help excrete that excess glucose. The higher your blood sugar goes, the more fluid you lose. And that creates a vicious cycle because dehydration doesn't remove sugar from the bloodstream. It concentrates it. Here's an easy way to picture what's happening. Imagine the same spoonful of sugar dissolved in a full glass of water versus a half empty glass. Same amount of sugar, very different concentration. That's what dehydration does to glucose readings. It doesn't create the problem, but it makes the numbers look worse, and it makes your body's ability to correct the problem harder. Hydration also affects hormone signaling in ways most people never hear about. One of those hormones is vasopressin, which rises when you're dehydrated. Chronically elevated vasopressin has been linked to impaired glucose regulation, higher fasting blood sugar, and increased diabetes risk, not because it causes diabetes, but because it reflects a body under constant fluid stress. In a large population analysis published in Physiology and Behavior, higher vasopressin activity was associated with worse glucose metabolism and higher diabetes incidence, while better hydration status tracked with healthier blood sugar control. Now, let's clear up a common myth. Water does not flush sugar out of your blood directly. That's not how physiology works. What water does do is support kidney function, improve blood volume, and reduce unnecessary hormonal stress, all of which make it easier for your body's glucose-lowering mechanisms to do their job. So if your blood sugar is running high right now, do this. Drink a full glass of water. Then keep sipping steadily over the next hour. No aggressive chugging, no forcing it, just consistent hydration. And here's the right way to think about it. Water isn't the hero that wins the battle. It's the thing that sets the stage so the rest of your tools actually work. It prepares the battlefield. Without hydration, movement works worse. Insulin signaling works worse. Your numbers stay stubbornly high longer than they need to. With hydration, everything else starts working the way it's supposed to. Number three, don't skip your next meal. Use it to calm your liver and improve insulin sensitivity. This is where a lot of people accidentally make things worse, even though they're trying to do the right thing. You see a high number and your instinct is, I shouldn't eat. I'll fast longer. I need to give my body a break. But if you're already insulin resistant, skipping your next meal often backfires. Here's why. When you don't eat, your body doesn't think, great, let's fix insulin resistance. It thinks we might be in trouble. Stress hormones rise, especially cortisol and glucagon. And those hormones send a very clear message to your liver. Release glucose now. So instead of calming your numbers, your liver dumps more sugar into your bloodstream. That's why people often see a second spike hours later, even though they didn't eat anything. The mastering diabetes approach flips this completely. Instead of skipping your next meal, you use it strategically to tell your liver and muscles, we're safe, you can stand down. And the way you send that signal is not by avoiding carbs, but by choosing the right kind of meal. Here's the rule we use. High fiber, low saturated fat, whole, intact plant foods. Not low carb, not high fat, not restriction. Why this works goes straight back to the root cause. Insulin resistance is driven largely by fat accumulation inside liver and muscle cells. Saturated fat worsens that congestion quickly. Fiber-rich, low-fat plant foods do the opposite. They gradually help clear that fat and restore insulin signaling. A recent review in Current Nutrition Reports walked through this exact mechanism, showing how diets low in saturated fat and rich in fiber improve hepatic insulin sensitivity and reduce inappropriate liver glucose output, the main driver of stubborn high fasting blood sugar levels. So instead of skipping food, your reset meal should look like this. A large volume of non-starchy vegetables or leafy greens, a generous serving of legumes, a whole food starch like potatoes, rice, or intact whole grains, no added oils. Now, I know what you're thinking. Chickpeas will spike me. And honestly, right now, they might. But that doesn't mean chickpeas are harmful. And it definitely doesn't mean they cause diabetes. What it means is that your cells are currently carbohydrate intolerant because insulin isn't working efficiently yet. The problem isn't the carbs, it's the traffic jam inside the cells. The goal of eating this way isn't to prove that carbs are harmless today. The goal is to make your cells more insulin sensitive over the next days and weeks so those same foods stop being a problem. This is the part that feels almost impossible to believe when you're new to this. And that's why we always say, don't just take our word for it. Go to masteringdiabetes.org and read the case studies. You'll see the same pattern over and over. People were skeptical. They were afraid of carbs. They expected their numbers to get worse. Instead, they're eating more whole carbohydrates than ever and seeing the best blood sugar of their lives. That's not willpower. That's not luck. That's insulin sensitivity improving. And once that happens, food stops feeling like the enemy. And if you don't know what to eat to reverse insulin resistance, comment guide below and we'll send you delicious recipes that make you more carbohydrate tolerant by improving insulin sensitivity. It's completely free. Comment guide below. Number four, calm your nervous system. Stress can raise blood sugar fast. Blood sugar is not controlled by food alone. It's also controlled by hormones, and stress hormones are some of the most powerful ones in your body. When you're anxious, frustrated, rushed, or panicking about a high number, your body releases cortisol and adrenaline. Those hormones send a very clear message to your liver. Release glucose right now. Your body thinks it's responding to a threat, and your liver doesn't care whether that threat is a tiger or a glucose meter. This is why blood sugar can rise even when you haven't eaten. And this is why stress management is not woo or optional. It's metabolic. A growing body of research shows that stress reduction practices like slow breathing, mindfulness, yoga, and relaxation training can meaningfully improve glycemic control in people with insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes. Not because these practices burn glucose, but because they change the hormonal signals controlling liver glucose output. A recent review published in Frontiers in Physiology breaks this down beautifully. The researchers analyzed multiple clinical trials and showed that stress reduction techniques consistently shift the autonomic nervous system out of fight or flight and into rest and digest. When that shift happens, cortisol and adrenaline levels fall, and liver glucose production drops with them. In other words, the liver stops acting like it's in emergency mode. And here's the part most people miss. In many of these studies, blood sugar improved without changes in calories, exercise, or weight loss. The only thing that changed was the signal coming from the brain to the liver. That's powerful. It also explains something you've probably experienced yourself. You eat the same meal, you can take the same walk, but on a high stress day, your blood sugar is worse. That's physiology. Your nervous system is talking directly to your liver. And when it's stuck in fight or flight, glucose keeps getting released whether you need it or not. So when you slow your breathing and intentionally calm your body, you're not just relaxing for mental health. You're actively changing how your liver behaves in real time. Here's a simple technique you can use immediately. Inhale slowly through your nose for 4 seconds. Exhale gently for 6 seconds. Repeat for 2 to 3 minutes. That longer exhale activates the parasympathetic nervous system, the rest and digest mode, and sends a signal of safety to your brain. As that signal settles in, liver glucose output begins to fall. Think of it this way. Movement opens the drain. Nutrition fixes the clog. Relaxation churns down the faucet. You need all three working together. Number five, track fasting glucose because you can't improve what you don't measure. This final step won't lower your blood sugar in 15 minutes, but it will prevent you from fighting the same battle every day. Fasting blood glucose is one of the clearest indicators of liver insulin sensitivity. When fasting glucose trends downward over weeks, it means your liver is releasing less glucose overnight, a sign that the root cause is improving. This is why we recommend measuring fasting glucose consistently. Not obsessively, not to judge yourself, but to collect data. Think of it like flying a plane. You can't feel subtle drift, but the instruments tell you whether you're moving in the right direction. Track fasting glucose alongside patterns: dinner timing, saturated fat consumption, fiber intake, sleep, and stress. Over time, the connections become obvious. And once insulin sensitivity improves, the emergency moments become rare because the system is working again. So before we zoom out, I want to be clear about something. This isn't just theory. This isn't just research. And this isn't something that only works in perfect conditions. This exact framework has helped thousands of people inside the Mastering Diabetes Coaching Program lower their blood sugar, improve insulin sensitivity, and take back control, often after years of frustration, confusion, and doing everything right. And the reason it works for them is the same reason it can work for you. Here's the big picture. High blood sugar is not a surface problem. It's a traffic problem. Glucose isn't high because you ate something bad. It's high because glucose can't get where it's supposed to go, and your liver keeps adding more to the pile. So every step you just learned targets a different part of that traffic jam. Movement opens muscle doors, allowing glucose to leave the bloodstream immediately, even when insulin isn't cooperating yet. Hydration supports blood volume and reduces hormonal stress, so glucose transport and kidney clearance can function the way they're designed to. Fiber-rich, low-fat meals clear fat out of liver and muscle cells, restoring insulin signaling at the root instead of masking the problem. Stress reduction turns down emergency glucose release by calming the brain-liver connection that keeps pushing sugar higher. Tracking fasting glucose shows whether liver insulin sensitivity is actually improving, so you're not guessing or reacting emotionally to isolated numbers. None of these steps work because they hack blood sugar. They work because they remove the reason it's high. And this is where food becomes powerful again, not as something to fear, but as a tool to reverse insulin resistance. If you want help applying this, comment guide below and we'll send you our favorite recipes designed specifically to improve insulin sensitivity and help your cells become carbohydrate tolerant again. This is the shift most people never make. Managing diabetes is about reacting to numbers. Reversing insulin resistance is about changing the environment inside your cells. That's why doing just one of these in isolation often feels disappointing. Walking without fixing diet helps temporarily. Eating well without managing stress still leaves glucose dumping. Tracking without behavior change just creates anxiety. But when all five levers move in the same direction, the system starts correcting itself. This is how you stop chasing numbers and start changing the biology underneath them. And once that biology changes, something powerful happens. Blood sugar stops feeling fragile. Meals stop feeling dangerous. And spikes stop controlling your day. So if today's number scared you, remember this. That number is not a verdict. It's feedback. And now you know exactly how to respond, not with fear, restriction, or guesswork, but with strategies that change the root cause. If this video helped you, hit the like button, subscribe to our channel, and share it with someone ready to improve their blood sugar. Until next time, keep those carbs high and that A1C low.